أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وآله الطاهرين صلى الله على محمد وآل محمد. After we discussed the concept of Mahdi عليه السلام, and we saw that it is a common concept among Sunnis and Shias, and then the false claimants, those who claim to be Mahdi, and well, it transpired that they were not, because they could not fill the earth with justice and equity. And we had regional Mahdis as well, who tried to fill their own region with justice and equity, and they couldn't do it. And these claimants were both from amongst Sunnis and Shias. Now we want to talk about the main figure, which is the focus of point of focus for Shias especially, and some Sunnis have alluded to his name as well, and that is Ibn al-Hasan al-Askari. This is what, of course, all Shia sources have alluded to, this name, they have alluded to the name. And of course, there has been lots of problems regarding the belief of the Shias in his person as the Shia developed through the history, mainly due to the strict taqiyya and the environment that the Imams and Shias were living in. It was not a sort of free flow of information from Imams to others, and therefore many people probably were not aware that Ibn al-Hasan al-Askari is going to be Mahdi, although his name was mentioned by the Prophet, as we will see later on inshallah. But even many Shias were not aware of that because of the strict dissimulation and of course a strict ban on information, especially from the Imams themselves, that they had told their followers, do not somehow spread this news unless you are sure of the of your audience. Now, this situation has caused some even Shia scholars of our time to doubt the idea of Ibn al-Hasan al-Askari being Mahdi alayhi salam and his occultation, and they have somehow provided some proof that this was a later development in the Shi'i thought. Of course, this was something which Orientalists had previously put forward as a theory. Then some Shi'i scholars have also follow their path. Now, we will discuss this inshallah next week, if God helps us. Some of the scholars have a different approach to this idea, like Dr. Sashadina and Professor Mudarrisi and others. We will discuss this next week. Now we want to, this week we want to focus and concentrate on the proof about Ibn al-Hasan al-Askari. Why we say that the Shias believed right from the beginning that Ibn al-Hasan al-Askari was the awaited Mahdi. Shias were waiting for that time. The Imams were waiting for the time of his birth, and of course later on the occultation and everything that took place. Now, a few evidence I want to mention here. There are ample traditions. You cannot count them, of course. You cannot put them in slides. In highly authentic Shia sources about the person of Mahdi alayhi salam, there is nothing that a Shia person can doubt. No room for doubt. Some allude to him vaguely, in the sense that they do not name him, but they give characteristics, gives a sort of address which would lead us to him, and others mention him by name. Now, a sample of such traditions are as follows. There are ample traditions which state that Mahdi is the ninth descendant of Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam. Now, these traditions are specifically important when the contention between Zaydis and the Imamis, the Imami Shi'is, grew hot, because the Zaydis believe that the Imam could be from the descendants of Hassan or Hussein. It doesn't make any difference. The only important thing are the characteristics that should be existent in the person of the Imam. Now, the traditions coming from the Prophet, from other Imams, which allude to the fact that the Imams are from the descendants of Hussein alayhi salam, and Mahdi is the ninth descendant. Now, let's look at some of these traditions. Qala Salman al-Farsi. This is a very well established and a very famous tradition from Salman al-Farsi, that he said, دَخَلْتُ عَلَى النَّبِي صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ فَإِذَا الْحُسَيْنُ بْنُ عَلِي عَلَى فَخِذِهِ وَهُوَ يُقَبِّلُ عَيْنَيْهِ وَيَلْثَمُ فَاهُ وَيَقُولُ أَنْتَ سَيِّدْ إِبْنُ سَيِّدْ أَنْتَ إِمَامٌ إِبْنُ إِمَامٌ أَبُو أَئِمَّهِ أَنْتَ حُجَّةُ اللَّهِ إِبْنُ حُجَّتِهِ وَأَبُو حُجَجٍ تِسْأَهُ مِنْ صُلْبِكَ تَاسِئُهُمْ قَائِمُهُمْ. I visited the Prophet while Hussein son of Ali was on his lap. He was kissing his eyes and was saying, you are noble, son of noble. You are Imam, son of Imam, father of Imams. You are the proof of God, son of his proof, and father of nine proofs, Hujaj, from your descent, the nine of whom is their Qa'im. So this is something which some Sunni sources have also mentioned that. Of course, you know, what is important about the hadith is the amount of emphasis that you put on it. So, for example, the hadith of Ghadir is mentioned in many Sunni sources, but the emphasis is not there. It doesn't somehow stand out as a concept of faith for them. While, for example, Shias, the emphasis is very great. On the other hand, there are some traditions about some companions which finds emphasis in their book that does not find emphasis in our book. And the important thing is that we probably sometimes have to revisit these traditions to see why the emphasis has been lost over the centuries. So some Sunni scholars have also mentioned, a number of Sunni scholars have reported this hadith, including Abu al-Mu'ayyad Muwaffaq Khwarizmi al-Hanafi in the seventh chapter of his Maqtal al-Husayn. You know, the very idea of writing Maqtal al-Husayn initially came from the Sunni world. Of course, if we put aside the Abu Mikhnaf, who was the original source of all Maqatil, it came from the Sunni source. Tabari, for example, included all Maqtal of Abu Mikhnaf in his book. And then many Sunni scholars started to write Maqtal. That's the story of the battle of Karbala. So this Muwaffaq Khwarizmi had a book, Maqtal al-Husayn, and in the seventh chapter he talks about merits of Imam Hussein. He mentions this tradition there in his book. Al-Hafiz al-Shaykh Sulaiman al-Ghunduzi al-Hanafi in Yanabi al-Mawadda, which is a book specifically dedicated to Mawaddatul Ghurba, the love of Ahlul Bayt, which was very common among Sunnis as well as in Shias. The latter has also reported Imam Hussein's account of the event. Now, it's very interesting because Salman says, I entered a Prophet's house to visit him and I saw Hussein on his lap and he was saying this. Now, Imam Hussein himself has an account of that event, certainly. This Qunduzi reports Hussein's account of the event. He says that it's reported from Imam As-Sajjad alayhi salam, from his father Imam Hussein, saying, I visited my grandfather Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He put me on his lap and told me, Allah has chosen 9 Imams from your descendants, the 9 of whom is their Qa'im. And all of them are equal in their merits and their position with God. Why these traditions are important? Because it somehow falsifies the theories which say the Shias initially didn't know who their Imams were going to be. It just unfolded this way. The Imams were known through the course of history, one after another, and it happened that they called the 12th Imam to be the Qa'im. These traditions falsify that. It says that right at the beginning, at the time of the Prophet, peace be on him, everything was quite clear for A'imma alayhi wa sallam, and it should have been. Certainly it should have been. It's because the knowledge which God had given the Prophet and his Imams would have included all these, this type of knowledge. Now, yes.
In this case, how come there is so much confusion even among Shia? For example, the Zaydis, and they weren't sure who is the Imam, this one or that one, and further along the chain. Every so often, again, they were not sure, is this the Imam or is that the Imam? When it was so clear, the names were even mentioned. Why does this happen?
Yeah, that's a very important question. The reason is that these were not widespread knowledge as we have them now. I mean, we have collected it from different sources now and put them in books. At that time, they were not collected and put in books. And there were vested interests as well. People did not want to accept the tradition, saying that we do not accept that this is from the Prophet. I mean, when the struggle for power comes, for example. Or when, for example, people did not like the attitude of Imam As-Sadiq alayhi salam or Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam, the quietism that they chose not to interfere very much in politics, they said, well, we cannot accept that you are Imams. And even if such traditions are there, they should not be authentic. However, the other reason is that, as I said, these traditions were not as known, as well known as we have them now together. And that's why, for example, the traditions that we are going to mention about the names of the Imams were not known by all Shias. It was the dissimulation, the taqiyya, which was very strict. These traditions were not widespread. Only very few companions of the Imams were aware of this, and others were not. Now, this anecdote that I'm going to mention now is a very good witness to what I am going to say. This Da'bal is a very, very prominent Shia personality, and still he doesn't know about who the Mahdi is. And we will see it here. And this shows how it was difficult to somehow have a sort of circulation of this information among even the Shias. There were lots of spies. There were lots of people who were just joined the Shia for different drives. And it was very difficult for the Imams to rely and somehow spread these sorts of information. There are traditions, that was traditions about what we mentioned, traditions about the Mahdi being the 9th descendant of Hussein. Now, there are ample traditions saying that Mahdi is the 4th descendant of Imam al-Reza alayhi salam. And why is this important? Because Imam al-Reza was thought to be the culmination of this Imamah. He was going to take the power because he was the heir apparent and all these things. And the news was somehow given, the information given to close disciples that no, Mahdi is going to be my 4th descendant. Not me, certainly, and I'm not going to do anything. It's Mahdi who should come, and he is the 4th descendant of mine. Tradition is stating that Mahdi is the 4th descendant of Imam al-Reza. The most beautiful of such traditions is the account, I don't know why T's have been omitted here, of the visit of the Imam by Da'bal. Now, Da'bal was a very famous poet. of the time who had lots of poetry on different issues. Even at the time of Harun al-Rashid, he was somehow summoned to the court, and for some while he used to compose poetry in the court, but he detested that and he ran away afterwards. And eventually he was killed by the caliph because of his stance regarding Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. But of course, killed when he was about 100 years old, so it didn't matter really. The meeting of Di'ab al-Khuza'i with Imam al-Raza. This is a very interesting story. It has been reported by both Shi'i and Sunni scholars, in which he recited his famous poem Madarisu Ayat. This is a very beautiful story. I mean, even the poetry, if unfortunately most of us here don't understand Arabic, otherwise it is a beautiful poetry which made Imam alayhi salam to cry several times, and at one point he fainted when Di'ab was reciting it because he cried so hard. The Imam fainted and the Khadim told Di'ab, stop it, do not recite your poem anymore. But Imam gained consciousness and told him, repeat right from the beginning. And it's a very beautiful story. It starts with this line, مَدَارِسُ آيَاتٍ خَلَتْ مِنْ تَلَاوَةٍ وَمَحْبِطُ وَحْيٍ مُقْفِرُ الْأَرَسَاتِ. The schools of ayat, that's the houses of the Ahlul Bayt, are now empty of any recitation, and the place where the revelation came down is now like a desert. And then it goes on, it's a very beautiful poetry. Like for example here, he says, Diyaru Rasulillah asbahna bulqa'a wa alu ziyadin taskunul hujurati. The houses of Rasulullah are now empty. No one lives in them. It's like a ruined place, and Alu Ziyad are living in nice houses. وَآلُ زِيَادٍ فِي الْقُصُورِ مَسُونَةٌ وَآلُ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ فِي الْفَلَوَاتِ. And Alu Ziyad are living in palaces, secure. Alu Rasulullah are running away in deserts from here to there. And it has a very beautiful piece about Imam Hussein alayhi salam, where Imam Reza cried very much. أَفَاطِمُ لَوْ خِلْتِ الْحُسَيْنَ مُجَدَّلًا وَقَدْ مَاتَ أَتْشَانًا بِشَطِّ فُرَاتِ. Fatima, if you could imagine what happened to your Hussein, and dying with thirst beside the Furat. And it's very beautiful. Anyway, I don't want to go to that. And then he says, وَحِينَ ذَكَرْتُ الْحُجَّةَ الْقَائِمَ أَجَّلَ اللَّهُ فَرَجَهُ بِقَوْلِي. In that poetry, I mentioned Al-Qa'im as well. Now, the interesting thing is that he didn't know who the Qa'im is going to be. He just mentioned that فَلَوْلَا الَّذِي أَرْجُوهُ فِي الْيَوْمِ أَوْ غَدٍ تَقَطَّعَ نَفْسِي إِثْرَهُمْ حَسَرَاتِ. If it was not for the hope that I know today or tomorrow is going to come, my soul would have been destroyed out of sorrow for what happened to them. خُرُوجُ إِمَامٍ لَا مُحَالَةَ خَارِجٌ يَقُومُ عَلَى اسْمِ اللَّهِ بِالْبَرَكَاتِ. And that hope is that the advent of an Imam which certainly is going to come and is going to rise in the Asmullah with blessings of Allah. يُمَيِّزُ فِينا كُلَّ حَقٍ وَبَاطِلٍ وَيُجْزِي عَنَ النَّعْمَاءِ وَالنَّقَمَاتِ. He is going to distinguish between right and wrong. And such descriptions that he gives. He says, when I recited this, فَوَضَعَ الرِّزَى يَدَهُ عَلَىٰ رَأْسِهِ وَتَوَاضَعَ قَائِمًا وَدَعَ بِالْفَرَجِ. Out of respect, Imam Reza put his head on his head and stood up and asked for the faraj. ثُمَّ رَفَى رَأْسَهُ إِلَيَّ وَقَالَ. Imam Reza placed his hand over his head and stood out of respect and prayed for his faraj. Then he looked at me and said, O Khuzai, Ruhul Qudus has spoken these two lines out of your tongue. You were not aware of what you were composing. It's Ruhul Qudus who has put this on your tongue. Do you know who is this Imam and when will he rise? I said, no, my Lord, I have only heard from my father that an Imam will rise from your family, who will fill the earth with equity and justice. Now, the important thing is here is that Debil, such a literate person, he even doesn't know that Mahdi is Ibn al-Hasan al-Askari. Why? As I said, this information was not widespread. However, now that we put them in books, later on when the Rawat came and compiled and put them in books, then we realized how many traditions we had in this respect. فقال لعليه السلام إن الإمام بعدي ابن محمد وبعد محمد ابنه علي وبعد علي ابنه الحسن وبعد الحسن ابنه الحجة القائم وهو المنتظر في غيبته. Now, he then said, the Imam after me is my son Muhammad, and after Muhammad will be his son Ali, and after Ali will be his son Hassan, and after Hassan will be his son Al-Hujjatul Qa'im. He's the awaited one in his disappearance, the obeyed one in his return, who will fill the earth with equity and justice after it's filled with injustice and oppression. But to say when will he rise is to foretell the time. Verily, my father reported to me from his fathers, from the messenger of God, that his example is like the example of the resurrection, which does not happen but out of a sudden. That means I don't know when he's going to rise, when is going the reappearance, when is it going to be. Even Imam Mahdi himself doesn't know. La ya'tikum, as about resurrection we have in the Quran, the Prophet says, I don't know when is that going to be. Yas'alunaka ka'annaka hafiyunana, they ask you as if you know. No one knows when the resurrection day is going to come. Thaqulat fis samawati wal ard la ta'tikum illa baghta. This knowledge is bigger than the whole universe can bear. So it just come out of a sudden. And Imam says here that the reappearance of Mahdi is like resurrection. It just comes out of a sudden. If you remember, we had a tradition from Sunni sources that his affair will be mended in one night. That means tonight, if inshallah tomorrow he is going to come, tonight he's told that the time is tomorrow, get ready. Not even the night before, not last night, not even today, just tonight he is going to be told that tomorrow is the time, get ready. So he himself doesn't know about it. And Imam says, because Debil asked him, when is he going to rise? And Imam says, the time, no one knows. So it's just like resurrection. It does not happen but out of sudden. Now you might ask, what about these portents, the signs of his reappearance that we hear? That if this, after this has happened and that has happened, these signs would not tell us exactly when the time is going to be. It just says it would not happen before this thing would have taken place. And you don't know how long after such a thing has taken place this is going to happen. Maybe thousands of years. Allah is very patient. It's إِنَّ يَوْمًا عِنْدَ رَبِّكَ أَلْفَ سَنَةٍ مِمَّا تَعُودُونَ. For us, one day is like 1,000 years that you count. So, as I said, the interesting thing about this tradition, which is very well known, I mean, this story of the Ebel is everywhere in books of history, that a person as close as the Ebel doesn't know at that time. And therefore, it might give some sort of substance to these theories that it unfolded as it went. The Shia didn't know about it. However, as I said, when these traditions were collected in one place, then we realized how much material was there, how much knowledge was there, which was not spread, of course, all over the place. Just before going to the next hadith, Imam Reza alayhi salam gave Da'bal 10,000 dirham of the coinage which was coined in his name. You know, when Imam Reza went to Khorasan, coins were minted in his name. Ali ibn Musa al-Reza. Especially the name al-Reza was there because it was important for Ma'mun to support this name al-Reza, because they said we all the time called in our revolution for al-Reza min Ali Muhammad, and this is al-Reza min Ali Muhammad. So it was important for him to coin the name al-Reza on the coins. And of course lots of these coins were given to Imam Reza to spend as he wished. And of course Imam Reza spent it in the best way possible to somehow support the Shias around the world. He gave Da'bal 10,000 dinars of this coinage. And Da'bal said, Ya Ibn Rasulullah, I have not composed this poetry for money. So please excuse me accepting this. So he gave it back to Khadim. And Imam told to Khadim, give it to him, he will need it. Don't argue with me. He said, I prefer to have a shirt of you, a dress that you have already worn. Imam gave him a dress, a very beautiful green fur dress. And he said, I have prayed in this. You may imagine how much the Imam appreciated the composition of this poetry. And he several times prayed for Da'bal because of composing this poem. And he told him that this dress I have prayed 1,000 night prayers in this clothes. And I have made 1,000 khatm of the Quran in this dress. So I give it to you. He said, I want it for my kafan. He said, take it. Now, when Da'bal came out, going towards Qom, of course there were people all around, they spread the news. You know what the Imam has given Da'bal? A dress in which he has prayed 1,000 night prayers and all these things. So when he reached Qom, you know people of Qom, you have been to Qom, of course. They stopped him. We wouldn't let you go. You have to give us the dress. He said, it's impossible, I'm not going to give it to you. They said, we buy it from you, 30,000 dinars. 30,000 dinars, you know, he could have bought 100 homes with it. They said, we give you 30,000 dinars, give it to us. He said, impossible, this is for my kafan. They said, okay, don't give it to us, go. He went, and then they intercepted him on the way and took it away from him. And they said, either take the money, or we don't give you the dress. He said, I'm going to complain to Imam Reza, but who cares? I mean, as they had the dress, who would have cared? He said, I'm going to complain to Imam Reza for what you are doing to me. At the end, they compromised with one sleeve given to Da'bal, and the rest they took it. And they gave the money. They gave the money and everything. They said, okay, we give you one sleeve and take the rest. And that one sleeve, when Da'bal reached Baghdad, his wife was seriously ill and had turned blind. And he was really in love with his wife. So he didn't know what to do. He just put that sleeve on her eyes, and she became seeing again. That was a miracle, of that sleeve of Imam Hussein's dress. And what happened in Baghdad, he saw that all his property was stolen. Imam had told him, take this money, you will need it. And people, when hearing that he had these coins minted with a river on them, they came and they bought each dirham for 10 dirhams. So he gained all his wealth back again with the money that people of Qom had given him and all these things. It's a very interesting, so it's a very long story you can find in different books. And we have lots of stories like this, the people who, especially these artists were special people and very popular with the Shias and with Imams, those of whom who were very, very sincere like them. Okay. Then there are traditions which state that he is the grandson of Imam al sorry, this should be Imam al-Hadi. Imam Ali al-Askari, not Hassan al-Askari. Now, Ikmal al-Din, Amal al-Saduq, al-Tawheed, they report through their chains from Abdul Azim ibn Abdullah al-Hassani. That's, of course, Abdul Azim, which is buried in Ray, near Tehran. An Ali ibn Muhammad, this is Imam al-Hadi, annahu qal al-imam min ba'di al-Hassan ibni. فَكَيْفَ لِلنَّاسِ بِالْخَلَفِ مِنْ بَعْدِهِ. The Imam after me is my son Al-Hassan, and how will people be with the successor after him? Or what do they do when the successor after him comes? And these traditions, of course, are abundant. Again, Saqar ibn Delf says, سَمِعْتُ عَلِي ibn Muhammad ibn Ali al-Rida, Imam al-Hadi, who was saying, Imam, the Imam after me is Al-Hassan, and after Al-Hassan will be his son Al-Qa'im, who will fill the earth with equity and justice, after it is filled with injustice and oppression. Again, Abu Hashim al-Ja'fari, سَمِعْتُ عَبَى الْحَسَنِ صَاحِبَ الْعَسْكَرِ يَقُولُ. Sahib al-Askari, you know, Imam al-Askari had lived in that military barrack since he was 4 years old with his father, Imam al-Hadi alayhi salam. And usually Imam al-Askari was called Sahib al-Askari, and his father as well, was, they were called Sahib al-Askari, those who resided in the barrack, in the military barrack. And it's very interesting. I mean, it was just like an occultation for the Shia. No one could access Imam al-Askari at his time. He, Imam al-Hadi, used to say, Al-Khalafu min ba'di ibn al-Hasan, fa-kayfa lakum bil-Khalaf min ba'd al-Khalaf. I heard Abu al-Hasan al-Askari saying, that's Imam al-Hadi, the successor after me will be my son al-Hasan, and how will you be with the successor after the successor? As, of course, the Qa'im. I said, why you say this? May I be your ransom? He said, because you would not see his person, and it is not permissible for you to mention his name. I said, so how should we mention him? He said, say the proof from Ali Muhammad, Al-Hujjah min Ali Muhammad. Now, of course, we may discuss this, why his name was not permitted to be mentioned, Muhammad ibn al-Hassan, and in all the hadith, when they wanted to write his name, they wrote Mim Ha Mim Dal ibn al-Hassan, because of these traditions. Now, of course, we are not in trouble for that, because, of course, there is no Banu Abbas to go after him, knowing that his name is what, and to search for him. But at that time, as I said, it was very, very strict. And because of that strictness, many people doubted that he was born at all. We will deal with this later on, and that's why some people have doubted that how could we establish that Imam al-Mahdi was born at all, if the dissimulation and if the strict sort of ban on this information was in place. Now, let's now come to specific traditions which mention the Imam by name. We have seen, of course there are other traditions saying that it's descendant of Imam As-Sadiq alayhi salam instead of Al-Kadhim alayhi salam, descendant of Al-Kadhim alayhi salam. But what was important here for us was being descendant of Al-Husayn alayhi salam, ninth descendant, fourth descendant of Al-Ridha alayhi salam, the grandson of Al-Hadi alayhi salam. These were the sort of traditions which were somehow told to people before his birth. Now, I want to discuss two traditions here which are reported in highly authentic books, mainly Al-Kafi and of course other books as well, which mention the name of every Imam, including Imam Al-Mahdi alayhi salam, from the Prophet, peace be on him. These are very important now for us, because here now we have a proof from Al-Kafi that the Prophet, peace be on him, and of course one of them is from the Prophet here. There are different traditions from the Prophet. One from the Prophet I have mentioned, one from Amirul Mu'mineen, which are very important. Now, Rawal Kulayni an iddat min ashabina. Shaykh Khulaini narrates from a number of his companions, from Ahmad ibn Muhammad al-Barqi, famous, of course, muhaddith, from Abu Hashim Dawood ibn Qasim al-Ja'fari, from Abu Ja'far the second. Abu Ja'far the second is Imam al-Jawad alayhi salam. So the report is from al-Jawad, and he attributes it to Amirul Mu'mineen alayhi salam. He said, Amirul Mu'mineen approached the sacred mosque of Mecca, and with him was Al-Hasan ibn Ali, who was leaning on the hand of Salman. Why? We don't know. They entered and sat down. When a man of nice appearance and attire approached them, he greeted Amirul Mu'mineen and sat down after receiving his reply. So he greeted Amirul Mu'mineen and Amirul Mu'mineen replied. ثُمَّ قَالَ يَا أَمِيرُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَا أَمِيرَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ أَسْأَلُكَ عَنْ ثَلَاثَ مَسَائِلَ إِنْ أَخْبَرْتَنِي بِهِنَّ عَلِمْتُ أَنَّ الْقَوْمَ رَكَبُوا مِنْ أَمْرِكَ مَا قَضَى عَلَيْهِمْ. I will ask you three questions. If you will answer them correctly, then I will know that the community has turned away from your affair in what was prescribed over them wrongly. They have wronged you. And that they are neither safe in their worldly affairs nor in the hereafter for what they have done with regards to you. However, if you are unable to answer them, then I will know that you and they are the same. So you just had a dispute over the power, and so you are the same. So Amirul Mu'mineen said, ask me whatever you wish. And he asked, inform me as to where the spirit of a human being goes when he sleeps. And how does a human being remember and forget? And how does a son resemble his paternal and maternal uncles? Now, very difficult questions. Even now we cannot answer them. It's not something that science can definitely answer, although we have some theories about it. Now, why this man was a knowledgeable man, certainly, and he wanted to show to some people the amount of knowledge of Amirul Mu'mineen, probably. Now, Amirul Mu'mineen turned to Al-Hasan and said, Ya Abu Muhammad, answer him. And Al-Hasan answered him, and he was satisfied. Now, the answers are not mentioned in the tradition, so don't ask me what are the answers for these questions. I don't know. Of course, we have some traditions with that regard, but this is not our concern at the moment. Now, he said, I testify that there is no God but Allah, and I have always attested to it. This man said. And I testify that Muhammad is the messenger of God, and I have always attested to it. And I testify that you, and he pointed to Amirul Mu'mineen, are the trustee of the messenger, wasi, of the Prophet. And I have always attested to it. I mean, I knew that from before, but I just wanted to somehow show your position here. And I testify that you, and he pointed to Al-Hasan, are his trustee, wasi. And I testify that Hussein ibn Ali is your wasi. And then he started to mention one by one. I testify that Ali ibn Hussein is his wasi. I testify that Muhammad ibn Ali is the wasi of Sajjad. I testify Ja'far ibn Muhammad. Until he came, and I testify that Musa ibn Ja'far is the imam by the command of Ja'far ibn Muhammad. And I testify that Ali ibn Musa is the imam by the command of Musa ibn Ja'far. And at the end he says, and I testify that a man from the offspring of Al-Hasan, after he says Hasan ibn Ali Imam al-Askari, is neither to be called nor to be named until his affair becomes manifest, and he will fill the earth with justice and equity, just as it was filled with tyranny, and peace be upon you, Amir al-Mu'mineen, as well as the mercy and blessings of Allah. Then he got up and went away. At that moment, Amir al-Mu'mineen said to Imam Hassan, O Abu Muhammad, follow him and see where he is headed for. So Al-Hasan went out and remarked, the man had hardly placed his foot outside the mosque when he vanished, and I didn't know where he had disappeared to. So I returned to Amir al-Mu'mineen and informed him about it. He said, O Abu Muhammad, do you know him? I replied, Allah, his messenger, and Amir al-Mu'mineen know better. He said, that was Al-Khidr. So this is known as Hadith al-Khidr, so to speak. And certainly Khidr should know about all these things. Even if we doubt that our imams should know, we shouldn't doubt that Khidr knows, because of the knowledge that we are reported about him in the Quran, that he knew the future of many things. And therefore, it's not amazing that Khidr should know about who is going to be the wasi of Amir al-Mu'mineen and after until al-Mahdi. Now, this is an important piece of literature, certainly. I mean, as it is reported by Al-Barqi, and Al-Kulayni has reported from Al-Barqi, and the chain is quite authentic, very well established chain. Again, you might say, okay, the hadith is reported by Imam Al-Jawad alayhi salam. He reports the story from Amir al-Mu'mineen. However, even at the time of Imam Al-Jawad, this type of knowledge coming was not very common and widespread among the people. Of course, there are different, probably, arguments about Khidr alayhi salam and his whereabout and whether he's still alive or not. But this is not the only incident in which Amir al-Mu'mineen encounters Khidr. There are several anecdotes that Amir al-Mu'mineen encountered Khidr alayhi salam. And you should certainly expect, if Khidr was alive and still is alive, he would always go to holy places, he would like to visit holy people, and certainly, of course, he would have loved to visit Amir al-Mu'mineen very frequently. And somehow, opening a conversation, a beautiful conversation with Amir al-Mu'mineen about things which were going to happen. Okay, the other one which all of you know about is Hadith al-Lawha Fatima. And this hadith, of course, is again very well known. The type of literature used in the tradition is a bit strange and is somehow offensive. And that's why I have seen some Sunni sources attack Shias for this hadith, and they say this is the fabricated hadith about their imams, and especially about Ibn al-Hasan al-Askari, Imam al-Mahdi, and they probably criticize for the for the sort of offensive language which is used, that I would destroy their enemies, I will do such and such to whoever oppressed them. And it's not like other tradition, like this tradition of Khazr, of course, was a very nice and smooth flow of information given. But here, it's not like that. It's just like a political manifesto coming out. Do you know why anyone who has read this ever thought why the literature of this hadith is so offensive? Any guess? Yeah, because it was an information given to Fatima when he was really outraged by what had happened. And that's why the hadith given to him was saying that I'm going to revenge what has happened. I'm going to put things right. And you should expect more things to come to your progeny. But do not worry, I will destroy the wrongdoers and oppressors. I think that's why the literature in this hadith is a bit offensive. Now, we'll go through it. We don't go through all of it, of course. I haven't probably written the translation, so you have to bear with me, just translate it as we read it. Now, Abu Basir An Abi Abdullah alayhi salam. This is from Imam As-Sadiq alayhi salam. Again, the hadith is in Kafi and many other books. Imam As-Sadiq says, Qala Abi Lajabir ibn Abdullah al-Ansari. My father, Imam Al-Baqir, said to Jabir ibn Abdullah al-Ansari, who was alive until his time, Inna li ilayka hajah. I need to see you, or I have some business with you. فَمَتَى يَخِفُّ عَلَيْكَ أَنْ أَخْلُوَ بِكَ أَسْأَلُكَ عَنْهَا. When do you have time so that I can come and visit you? Look how Imam Al-Baqir is talking to Jabir. Why? Because Jabir is now a very, very old companion of the Prophet, and Imam respects him to this state, to this extent, that he says, when do you have time? I come and visit you because I want to ask you something. It's amazing. I mean, the way Jabir is treated by Imam As-Sajjad, by Imam Al-Baqir, is really amazing. If Imams are really respecting their followers like this, then thank you so much. Inshallah, we will become their sincere followers. قال له جابر أي الأوقات أحببت. Whenever you wish, of course you are most welcome. One day Imam عليه السلام went and visited Jabir, and he said, يا جابر أخبرني عن اللوح الذي رأيته في يد أم فاطمة بنت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. Inform me of the tablet, loh is a plaque or a tablet or something, that you saw in the hand of Fatima bint Rasulullah. And what did Fatima tell you about it? وَمَا أَخْبَرَتْكَ بِهِ أُمِّي أَنَّهُ فِي ذَلِكَ اللَّوْ مَكْتُوبٌ. And what did my mother told you, which was written in that tablet? فَقَالَ جَابِر أشهد بالله أني دخلت على أمك فاطمة بنت رسول الله. I take Allah as my witness. I visited your mother Fatima. فهنيتها بولادة الحسين عليه السلام. It was when Hussein was born. So I just wanted to congratulate her for the birth of Hussein عليه السلام. Then ورأيت في يدها لوحا أخضر. I saw a green tablet in a hand. ظننتُ أنه من زمرد. I thought it was made of emeralds, so shining. ورأيت فيه كتابا أبيض شبه نور الشمس. I saw there were lines written. I saw a handwriting in that emerald-like tablet, which was shining like the lights, the rays of sun. فَقُلْتُ بِأَبِي أَنْتِ وَأُمِّي يَا بِنْتَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ مَا هَذَا اللَّهُ. I said, may my father and mother be your ransom, daughter of the Prophet. What is this? What is this tablet? She said, هَذَا اللَّهُ أَحْدَاهُ اللَّهُ إِلَى رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صلى الله عليه. This is something that Allah has, just when someone has a child and the families would offer a present, this is a present for the birth of Hussein, Allah has given to the prophets. فيه اسم أبي واسم بعلي واسم ابني واسم الأوصياء من ولدي. In this tablet is the name of my father, name of my husband, name of my sons, اسم ابني, my two sons, and the name of the أوصياء after them, from my progeny. And the Prophet has given it to me so that I become happy. فقال جابر فأعطتنيه أمك فاطمة فقرأته واستنسخته. Fatima gave it to me, I read it. Of course, in one other version of the tradition is that Fatima told him that I cannot give it to you, but I read for you. And he wrote what Fatima had read from the tablet. I wrote it, Jabir says, I wrote it. I read it and I wrote it. وَاسْتَنْسَخْتُ. Imam al-Baqir said, فَهَلْ لَكَ يَا جَابِرْ أَنْ تُعْرِضَهُ عَلَيَّ. Can you read it for me, what you read in that tablet? Or can you show me, not read it, can you show me the paper or the piece of parchment on which you have written what was in that tablet? فمشى معه أبي إلى منزل جابر فأخرج صحيفة من رق. They went to his house and Jabir brought a piece of parchment. Now, here is very interesting. The Imam says, Jabir, you look into that parchment and I read for you what is in it. So, actually the Imam just wanted to compare what was written by Jabir in the parchment and his own knowledge of the tablets. قال يا جابر انظر في كتابك لأقرأ عليك. You look into that parchment and I'll read for you. فنظر جابر في نسخته فقرأه أبي فما خالف حرف حرفا. My father read it and no one letter was wrong. There was no disagreement. فقال جابر أشهد أني هكذا رأيته. Jabir says, I witness that I saw it the way you read it for me. Now, in the law it was written, هذا كتاب من الله العزيز الحكيم لمحمد النبي. This is a letter from Allah العزيز الحكيم to Muhammad, his prophet, ونوره وسفيره وحجابه ودليله. His light, his ambassador, his hijab, which is between him and the people, his guide, نزل به الروح الأمين من عند رب العالمين. And then some sort of praise for Allah. And then he says, إني لم أبعث نبيا فأكملت أيامه وانقضت نبوته إلا جعلت له وصية. I never have given mission to a prophet who after he finished his time, there was a wasi for him, someone who could carry on with his mission, although there was no revelation, but could carry on with his mission. And then the law says one by one, after you will be Ali, and there will be this and this will happen, after him there will be such and such, it comes to Imam al-Reza, and Ma'mun will شر خلقه will kill him and he will be buried somewhere, and all this information is given until it comes here. ثم أكمل ديني بابنه, sorry, أخرج منه الداعي إلى سبيلي. After he mentions Imam al-Hadi, he says, I will bring out from him someone who called to my path and someone who is the store of my knowledge, Al-Hasan al-Askari. ثم أكمل ديني بابنه محمد رحمة للعالمين. Then I will complete my religion with his son Muhammad. Now here the name Muhammad is mentioned, who is the mercy for alameen. عليه كمال موسى وبهاء عيسى وصبر أيوب. He has the perfection of Musa. He has the glory, بهاء, the glory of Isa عليه السلام, and patience of Ayub, he should have, certainly. سيد أوليائي, and سيدل أوليائي في زمانه. My أولياء, my friends will be humiliated in his time. That means in the time of his occultation. And then it continues. Now, the importance of this hadith has different versions. Again, the importance is that it comes from Imam Ja'far al-Sadr, first of all. It doesn't go to Imam al-Jawad alayhi salam. And it talks about this knowledge being told by Fatima from a law given to her by the Prophet, peace be on him. Now, if we want to somehow compile such traditions, it will be a real book. However, as I said, the reason why this information was not widespread at the time of A'imma alayhimus salam was that because A'imma alayhimus salam, even when they informed their companions of this knowledge, they told them, you do not spread this. You just write it somewhere and leave it and keep it for some time to come later on. And this is how the reporters collected these traditions. As I said, today we know about Imam al-Mahdi alayhi salam more than the companions of our A'imma. The companions of our A'imma did not know as much as we know about Imam al-Mahdi alayhi salam, because of, first of all, the lifting of the simulation, all these traditions coming to one place, to reliable books, and we read from those books, and our knowledge today is much more than the knowledge of the companions of A'imma alayhim as-salam. Now, next week when we are dealing with with some doubts about this person of Mahdi and theories which are put forward, that this type of idea of occultation and these things came later on, as of course the Imam did not appear, or the Shias had not seen the son of Al-Hasan al-Askari, we will discuss the importance of these traditions, inshallah. Now, also, we have traditions from the Imams. Yes.
Sheikh, the last part of that hadith, you said he will be humiliated in his lifetime.
No. He's my awliya, will be humiliated during his time. That means the time of his occultation. Not, of course, when he comes, because he's Mu'azzul awliya.
No. So what does that mean, they'll be humiliated in his occultation?
They will be killed. They will be imprisoned. They live in a world in which God has no respect. If they really want to show what they believe, even the believers would not accept from them, and these sort of things, that they would be humiliated. Now, another tradition which mentions the A'imma by name, and this is very important because this is something which has come in Wasa'il al-Shia, which has come in Shaykh Saduq's book as well. He reports with an authentic chain from Abdullah ibn Jundab from Musa ibn Ja'far alayhi salam, who said, say in your prostration of thanksgiving, Sajdatul Shukr. When you go to Sajdatul Shukr, say this, Allahumma inni ushhiduka wa ushhidu malaikatak wa anbiya'aka wa rusulak wa jami'a khalqik annaka anta Allah rabbi wal islam dini wa muhammadan nabi wa aliyan wal hasana wal husayn wa ali ibn al husayn wa muhammad ibn ali wa ja'far ibn muhammad wa musa ibn ja'far wa ali ibn musa wa muhammad ibn ali wa ali ibn muhammad wal hasan ibn ali wal hujjat ibn al hasan a'immati, these are my imams, bihim atawalla wa min a'da'ihim atabarra. So I certainly love them and obey them, and I dissociate from their enemies. Now again, this is a very authentic tradition coming from Musa ibn Ja'far alayhi salam. Again mentioning all the Imams by name, and even mentioning of course Hujjat ibn al-Hasan, who, as I said, if you want to bring all these traditions together in one place, we will have a big book from all these bits and pieces which are reported from different A'imma alayhi salam. Now, let's see some statements from Imam al-Hasan alayhi salam, Imam Hasan al-Askari alayhi salam himself, which is very important, because we say that Imam needs a nas from the previous Imam. That's a clear statement that who is the Imam after me. That is what an Imam needs. Now again, Saduq mentions that from several people, of course, this is from Muhammad ibn al-Attar, which is a contemporary of Imam al-Askari alayhi salam, or immediately after him. This is from several people, Muawiyah ibn Hakim, Muhammad ibn Ayyub ibn Nuh, and Muhammad ibn Uthman al-Amri, one of the Nawab, of course. They said, these people said, قَالُوا أَرَضَ عَلَيْنَا أَبُو مُحَمَّدْ أَلْحَسَنِ ابْنَ عَلِي إِبْنَهُ وَنَحْنُ فِي مَنْزِلِهِ. They said, Imam al-Askari showed us his son, and while we were in his house. Now, so they should have been very, very close and trusted. As I said, when Imam al-Askari alayhi salam married, they put guards and midwives to inspect his wife every now and then to see if she is pregnant or not. And therefore, they were very much aware that there should be a son for Imam al-Askari alayhi salam. This is very interesting, because Al-Mufid rahmatullah alayhi mentions about this secret birth of Imam al-Mahdi alayhi salam, that the critics would say that if he was the Imam, why secret birth? And if the secret birth, how should we know that he was born? How should we know that he was the Imam? And he says that exactly like Musa alayhi salam, he had a secret birth. Why? Because they wanted to kill him. Like Ibrahim alayhi salam, he had a secret birth because they wanted to kill him. And you should not expect in that environment Imam al-Askari coming out and celebrating and saying that, yes, I have a son, and everyone come and see, so that they could witness that I have a son and he is going to be the Imam. However, there were handpicked of his companions whom he trusted, and he took to his home, and he showed the Imam to them and said, this is my wasi. And then after that, of course, probably all these companions could see him once or twice, not more than that. And in some occasions, for example, he invited 40 of his companions, showing the Imam to them that he was born. And then, of course, they couldn't see him anymore, so that if the guards came, they could not find anything. And we will mention that where the Imam was kept after he was born, because even the Shias don't know where was he kept? In Medina, in Mecca, in Samirra, where? They just sometimes they that Imam wanted, he invited them, just showed him, and that was all. And after that, no one knew where he was living. Certainly, he was not living in Imam's house. That's for certain. Because there was the possibility of raiding his house at any time. So, these people say that Imam Abu Muhammad al-Hasan ibn Ali showed us his son. وَنَحْنُ فِي مَنْزِلِهِ وَكُنَّ أَرْبَعِينَ رَجُلًا We were 40 people there. فَقَالَ هَذَا إِمَامُكُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِي He said, this is the Imam after. وَخَلِيفَتِي عَلَيْكُمْ And my Khalifa over you. Obey him and do not divide in your ways after me, lest you perish. Beware. You will not see him after this day. That means you see him only once, not more than that. And this is just to establish that he's more. That's all. Not, I don't want you to know him or to talk to him or whatever. It's just to know that he's born. أَمَا إِنَّكُمْ لَا تَرَوْنَهُ بَعْدَ يَوْمِكُمْ هَذَا And they said that we left the house and only after a few days the Imam passed away. So it shows because at that time Imam al-Mahdi alayhi salam should have been about 5 years old. And these people had not seen him before that time, before that. These are the most trusted people, of course. Maybe a couple of them like Muhammad ibn Uthman and others had seen him before. But Imam just showed his son to them a few days before he was to pass away. And then, as I said, certainly the Imam was kept in a very, very secret place, well protected, in terms of information, certainly. Okay, any questions? Discussions, questions? Yes.
Sorry, before you mentioned Nabi Ibrahim had a secret birth. Yes. We haven't heard of this before. Can you please explain?
Oh yes, this is very famous. That the same dream which Pharaoh had, the king of his time had as well. And therefore, and the situation was as such that they knew that in certain families this is going to be the case. And Ibrahim was given to someone to be killed. And he did not kill him and kept him in a cave. And some people say that these verses in Surah An'am, which says, when he came and saw the star, he said, قَالَ هَذَا رَبِّي And this is the moon, قَالَ هَذَا رَبِّي They say that, of course it's not true, but they say that it was when he just had come out of the cave. And he really didn't know what these things are. And he was thinking about who had created him. This is not true, of course. It doesn't go with the verses very well. But they have said this because the secret birth of Ibrahim was very famous as well.
Thank you. Riaz?
Thank you very much for your lecture. Sheikh, just to make it very clear in my mind, the hadith, the various ones that we've heard about today, and this is going to be very important for next week. Are they absolutely authentic? Is there no element of doubt whatsoever in terms of their veracity, either from the Ahlul Sunnah or from the Shia or whoever?
Well, certainly the Ahlul Sunnah would not accept these traditions. These are traditions from Shi'i sources. From Shi'i point of view, yes, the traditions are highly authentic. The chains are quite reliable. And they are in books like Al-Kafi, At-Tahdhib and other books, Man La Yahturu Al-Faqih and other books, which are the main canonical books of Shia traditions. Therefore, there is no doubt about the authenticity. There are other traditions which are less authentic, which I did not mention here, and they are somehow they would corroborate and support these traditions, but these are very highly authentic traditions, yes.
Thank you. We go to sisters before we come back to brothers. Any sisters? No?
Assalamu alaikum. Coming back to the hadith of Al-Khidr alayhi salam, when he refers to Imam Al-Hujjah alayhi salam, he says he is neither to be called nor to be named till after his affair becomes manifest. What's the meaning of this statement?
Yeah, just like now. His affair has become manifest. Now everyone knows that he is Ibn al-Hasan al-Askari, and there is no harm to name him anymore. But probably until several decades, it was really dangerous to mention his name. Not for himself probably, because no one knew where he was. Maybe for his followers it was dangerous as well to mention a name and people say, you are the one who are following Muhammad ibn al-Hasan. Because the Prophet said, Esmuhu Esmuhi, his name is my name. So they didn't want actually to mention that there is a newborn in the house of Al-Hasan al-Askari whose name is Muhammad, which brings again all those, invokes those fears of Banu Abbas. Because Banu Abbas, the poor guys, they thought that he is going to rise just right in their time. They didn't know this is going to take long. If they knew, they wouldn't have bothered very much, certainly. Yeah.
Thank you. Any sisters before we come back to the brothers? Yeah, can you take the mic, please?
Alaykum salam.
Assalamu alaikum. We've also heard that we can't, I don't know, I've heard this as we were growing up, that we can't call Imam Mahdi by his full name, which is Muhammad al-Mahdi. Is there a particular reason for that?
Yeah, this is what we discussed. It's not for our time anymore.
Oh, okay.
It was for the time when his affair was not manifest. Now, of course, everyone knows, we know his name, so it doesn't matter if you call him by his name.
Yeah. Thank you, Taha.
Sheikh.
Alaykum as-salam.
Just to put it in context, you state that these are very authentic Shiite hadith. That begs the question that are there hadith without, which are authentic but are not very authentic? And second is, the compilation of these ahadith by Suduq and Kulaini, what is the time gap when they were put together? Thank you.
Well, in Shia hadith, fortunately, we have no time gap, actually. In Sunni hadith, we have time gap of about 140 years. When they started to write traditions, because there was a ban on writing hadith by the second caliph, and so everything was transmitted orally until the topple of the Banu Umayyah were toppled and the ban was lifted. And at the time of Banu Abbas, right at the beginning, especially at the time of Abu Ja'far al-Mansur, who really encouraged the compilation of hadith for several reasons, of course, for his own reasons, when the scholars at his time started to compile, write books, and then in the 3rd century it came to Bukhari and Muslim and others. In Shia traditions, we don't have this gap, because the companions of the Imams wrote whatever they heard from the Imam. They had many books. Just to give you an estimate of how many books they wrote at the time of the Imams, Shaykh Hurr al-Amali in Wasa'il al-Shia, he mentions that from the time of Amir al-Mu'mineen to the time of Hasan al-Askari alayhi salam, that's a span of about 220 years, the Shias wrote 6,600 books of tradition, companions of the Imams. Now, the names of all these books, of course not all these books are extant anymore, and of course there's good reason for that, why they are not extant. I mentioned that, but the names of all these books were indexed in books like Tusi's book, Najashi's book, people before them who indexed these books, Fihrist. And we know of these books from those indices, those indexes, which are in our hand at the moment. Now, people like Saduq and Kulaini, they compile their books referring to these original usul. They called it asl. And they said that there were 400 of these 6,600 which were completely reliable. No Shia scholar had any doubt about them. And these 400 usul are the books which were used by Kulaini and by Sadhu and by others to compile their own books. Now, after a book like Al-Kafi is compiled, it's a very handy book. It has all traditions from all those smaller books in one place, and you would imagine that no one refers to those books anymore. They just read Al-Kafi or Malayas or Al-Faqih. So those books are not copied anymore. So they just vanish, they are destroyed. And these better books, bigger books, they remained. So there is no gap in Shia tradition. And when you, for example, when you see a chain of transmission in Al-Kafi, you see names. But Al-Kulaini certainly does not report orally from them. He has referred to their books. That means, this man, I saw his book, and I read it to him, and he had seen the book of the previous reporter, and he had read it to him, and until it goes to the Imam alayhi salam. Now, when we say highly authentic, yes, we have different values for different books. For example, the books of Saduq, even if the chain of transmission is authentic, is very sound, if it appears in Man la yahdhuru al-faqih, we give it more weight than if it appears in Al-Amali, for example, or in At-Tawheed. Why? Because this is the book that Saduq says, I have tried not to bring anything unless I rely on it myself. So that is a support for it. Other books, he says, I report these traditions here. He doesn't say, he doesn't witness. But in this book, yes. Or Kulaini says, I have brought the traditions I know. Just like Bukhari and Muslim. However, of course, the type of reliance on Bukhari and Muslim which is found in the Sunni world is not found in the Shia world in relation to Kulaini and Saduq. Because we say again, these are the men who compile this according to their own judgment. We have to have our judgment on what they have compiled. So we don't think that there is a Sahih book which there is no doubt in it, like Al-Bukhari and Muslim in the Sunni world. It's different sort of perspective towards Hadith.
Thank you. Ladies, before we come to brothers again. Yeah, can you pass the mic?
Assalamualaikum. Correct me if I'm wrong, but did you just say that Hadith is originating from the sixth Imam through the chains of narrations where are regarded as more reliable than those coming from the Imam al-Jawad?
No, no. What I meant was that this is a tradition which goes back to the sixth Imam, which is earlier in time. I mean, some people might say, okay, this is from Imam al-Jawad, okay? And this might have been somehow a make of the reporters of that time who had access to that knowledge, which was more widespread. But when we go to the time of Imam Sadiq alayhi salam, that's an earlier time informing us about this event. Not that there is difference in knowledge between them. Yeah.
Thank you. We'll have the last question from the brothers now.
Assalamu
alaikum.
Sheikh, is it true that, in your opinion, that the compilation by Shaykh al-Sudur regarding the 12th Imam alayhi salam, that it is on the authority of the 12th Imam himself, as it is mentioned in the foreword of the compilation, that he has compiled through the authority of the 12th Imam?
I don't know. Has he mentioned that? Through the authority of the Sultan. That means he has met the Imam himself.
I have heard this. This is why I'm saying this.
No, I don't think this is the right piece of information. Otherwise, who would dare to discuss any piece of information in that, if that's the authority of the Imam himself? Now, certainly, no one can claim that they had access to Imam after, especially after the major occultation, which of course was the time of As-Saduq, even before the major occultation, no one could claim that they had access to Imam for any piece of information.
We'll call it a day here. Shukran. Muhammad Ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli.